this evening, we shall discuss about balancing and sharpening five mental faculties. Meditators must be endowed with sharp and strong mental faculties in order to make progress. During the practice, meditators also have to keep mental faculties in balance. So even though meditators might think that his mental faculties or her mental faculties are not strong, but they should not feel disheartened because there are ways to strengthen the mental faculties. The first way, as explained in the commentaries, that meditators must keep in mind that he or she will be able to realize the passing away or dissolutions of the mental and physical phenomena when they observe them as they really are. So they must bear in mind that they are able to see the passing away or dissolutions of the conditioned phenomena. Realizing the passing away or the dissolutions of the conditioned phenomena is important so that meditators could understand the nature of anicca or impermanence through direct experience. But when the mindfulness getting better, sharper, meditators also could see the arising of the conditioned phenomena precisely and the passing away of the phenomena as well. Then the second way is that meditators must practice mindfulness meditations seriously or with respect. So you must take this practice seriously. One has confidence that this mindfulness will lead me to remove all kinds of impurities or defilements. Only one who practices mindfulness seriously with respect, will achieve the aims or the goals of mindfulness meditation. Then the third way is that mindfulness of mental and physical phenomena or mental and physical processes must not be interrupted. In those must be constant and continuous. So we always remind mindfulness meditators to develop constant and continuous mindfulness for a longer and longer period of time. Then other ways mentioned in the commentaries, for example, one's not one must not worry about one's body or just one's bodily health or even one's life. Or, if one has a lot of worries about one's physical health, one may not be able to put forth effort, or one's not willing to put a lot of effort into the practice. Then another way is that whenever there's a mental pain or physical pain arising, one should strive to mindful and know it constantly, continuously. One has to develop patience and increase the level of tolerance gradually, so that one could realize the true natures of the mental pain or physical pain. Then the commentary also explained another way is that one must not stop halfway to one's goal or aim of mindfulness meditation. So in other words, one should mindful and note every phenomenon constantly, continuously, as long as one has not yet realized the ultimate aim of mindfulness meditation. One must not put down one's effort. So the cause of constant and continuous mindfulness is effort or virya. So virya means effort. And it's not an ordinary effort. One must put forth a strenuous effort into practice. And the scriptures explain further that effort must be ever increasing. One has to increase the effort gradually. And the effort must be firm. And then one should not put down one's responsibility. In Pali it's known as anikita duro. Duro means responsibility. Anikita means not putting down. So what's your responsibility as a human? In Pali it's known as manusa. The ancient philosopher explained manusa as one who has a noble mind. As one has not yet developed one's own mind to become noble, then one should not put down one's responsibility. In other words, every human has this responsibility to purify his own mind or her own mind from all kinds of mental defilements such as greed or hatred, delusion, and so on. So if you have this effort, then you will not put down your responsibilities. So in the course of the practice, it's important to mindful and note your mental states, such as feeling of frustration or disappointment when one is not able to attain deep concentration or to realize the passing away of the mental states or any phenomena clearly. So it's important to mindful and note such negative mental states. Sometimes one might harbor thoughts or doubts or a doubt that this is the not the time for me to achieve the final goal or to attain any path knowledge because my parami is not yet ripening. If one entertains such thoughts, this not yet my time, my parami is not ripening, then most likely one will not put forth effort. One maybe put forth a half-hearted effort. So that's why one must be firm in one's aspirations or determination to achieve the ultimate aim of mindfulness meditations. One must not allow oneself to have a second thought on that I'm not going to be successful. I might as well not wasting my time and energy here. So it's important to mindful and note such negative thoughts. So meditators may not able to see clearly the progress, but if they do practice with patience and constantly, continuously, they may able to see themselves transforming, for example, less and less mental defilement arising. The mind is getting calmer, one is getting more patient, and so on. It's important to practice mindfulness with wholesome thoughts. In other words, be free from defilements. In fact, there are, besides five mental hindrances that obstructs the progress. There are another three kinds of defilements that obstructs the progress. or they are the obstacles to the progress. The scriptures name these obstacles as papancha in Pali. Papancha means obstacles to the spiritual training, to the progress of spiritual trainings or meditation. One is craving or attachments. The other is a conceit. Conceit in Pali means mana. It means there's a strong feeling of pride. And the third is a ditthi, wrong view. This is explains in the scriptures and the commentaries. If one is craving, craving, or has some attachment to the experience meditation, then it will become a obstacles to the progress of meditation. When meditators crave for some experience or has some attachments to experience, then they may put forth more effort to experience it again or to sustain it again. But when they have strong desire to re-experience again, when they could not experience it again, then they will be feeling of frustration, disappointment. Meditation is a process of experience. So this experience is also subject to impermanence. It doesn't remain the same all the time. So meditation is a process of experience. The meditators crave or attach to certain experiences, then it becomes a hindrance. So meditators should be mindful and note the mental states. Sometimes there's a feeling of conceit. Conceit means feeling proud, or there's a lot of feeling of pride that I'm better than other yogis, or my mindfulness or my insight knowledge is sharper, better than others, and so on. Meditators must be very mindful of the mental states. And it's important to keep the five mental faculties in balance. The five mental faculties are in Pali, or Sadda, Virya, Sati, Samati, Sati and Samadhi, and Panya, confidence, or effort, mindfulness, concentration, and wisdom. So here, confidence of faith means faith with understanding. Virya, effort must be strenuous. ever increasing. Be firm, and sati mindfulness must be constant and continuous. Concentration must be deep enough. In other words, mindfulness meditators must develop moment-to-moment mindfulness in order to attain momentary concentration. Wisdom's of panya is realization of true nature of mental and physical phenomena through direct experience. And that realization is also conducive to the realizations of the Four Noble Truths. So during the practice, meditators have to keep the two pairs of mental faculties in balance. The first pair of mental faculties consists of saddha or confidence and apanya or wisdom. The second pair consists of the mental faculties of virya effort and samadhi concentration. But sati or mindfulness need not we do not have to keep these faculties in balance with any of the four faculties, and we should be endowed with mindfulness all the time. The only problem is meditators might be lacking of mindfulness at certain times. If these mental faculties are not kept in balance, then meditators will not be able to make progress. For example, if the faith or confidence is very strong, yet the wisdom is weak, then the commentary say that a meditator who has a strong faith or faith in the faith and wisdom is very weak, one will become credulous. Credulous means one believe in anything easily. One even could be easily deceived by others. If one has a strong faith, yet the wisdom is weak, then it's not conducive to the progress. But when one's wisdom is very strong, and the faith or confidence is weak, then one could not make progress as well. Here, wisdom means wisdoms or knowledge gained by hearing from others, or by reading book, or the knowledge gained by one's own thinking or analyzing. Or when one is endowed with a lot of scripture knowledge, but doesn't have much experience in the Dharma. Experience in the Dharma is gained through mental development or meditation. So when one has a lot of wisdom, there's a tendency to analyze the practice or the experience during meditations. Sometimes one would analyze their experience in accordance with the scriptures. So they you keep on analyzing, thinking. They become unmindful. When they are not mindful, they could not gain real experience. It's because the mindfulness is disturbed or distracted by thinking, analyzing. So when a meditator could not gain much personal experience or direct experience in the practice of mindfulness, sometimes they could not analyze the experience correctly. They could not gain the real experience or the actual experience. So because the personal experience is poor or weak, eventually doubts will arise. Doubt arises, for example, whether or not this way of practicing is correct, whether this way of practice is in accordance with the scriptures, and so on. So it's important to put aside the knowledge or wisdoms gained by hearing or listening from others or through readings. So that one could gain direct experience. As you know, words or concept cannot explain fully the experience of meditations. The word, in other words, the mental noting, will lead the mind to the experience of the phenomena. For example, you note pain, then you should fully experience the process of pain, not analyzing the pain, not categorizing the pain. For example, some meditators analyze the pain into various nature, such as cutting pain, piercing pain, dull pain, and so on. So they need not have to analyze. They do not mindful the mental noting, although meditators are conscious of the mental noting, but they should pay attention to the object or the phenomenon that was noted at the time, so that they could fully experience the nature of pain or the nature of the phenomena as they really occur. Sometimes meditators might be thinking whether or not did I see the passing away of the object or the phenomenon clearly. If they are thinking, did I perceive the passing away of the object clearly? At that time, there's no mindfulness. When there's thinking, there's no mindfulness. So that thinking disrupted the mindfulness. If meditators keep on thinking, or there's a strong desire to find out whether or not did I perceive or see the passing away of the objects, every object clearly, they may not able to gain clear experience. Eventually, they may experience more frustrations. So we know what is passing away. What is the meaning of disappearing or vanishing? We understand it, but we need to gain direct experience into it. It's not possible to explain further with various concepts or words. That's why in meditation, we need to develop mindfulness in order to gain direct experience or personal experience. When we practice mindfulness, what you want to realize is ultimate reality, or in other words, the ultimate truth. We can't realize ultimate reality or ultimate truth through words or concepts, or through thinking or speculations. It's beyond ultimate reality or ultimate truth, or it's beyond words or concepts. We can only realize ultimate truth through personal experience or direct experience. So just like one might ask, so what does a durian, a kind of favorite fruits in Southeast Asia, one might ask, what does a durian taste like? One can never know it well through words or by way of an explanation. But when one has a chance to taste it himself, herself, then through that experience, you remove that question from the mind. Similarly, if one's concerned about what's like passing away or this dissolution, it's not possible to experience with words. One must know it directly or personally. So it's important even to put aside the idea of the concepts of impermanence, suffering, no self or not self. Sometimes some meditators my report during the interview that they have been mindful or observing arising and passing away. But in the reality, we do not observe, or in the sense observing arising and passing away. We should observe various mental and physical phenomena as they really occur and experience directly their processes. So when meditators could experience every process of mental phenomena or every process of physical phenomena as it is, then they come to realize their true nature through personal experience or direct experience. They do not realize them through thinking or conceptualizing. They merely observing, watching, be mindful. That's why we want to, what we should give, should be gain, it should be gain is known as intuitive knowledge. So it's important to put aside theories or preconceived idea or preconceptions. Then meditators will be able to mindful or paying bare awareness or bare attention to what the object is arising at that moment. Then the other two mental faculties, effort should be kept in balance with a concentration. If the effort is too strong, that it can cause the mind restless. So there's a well-known scriptures in that scriptures there's a simile to explain about balanced effort. So it's like the string of the musical instruments. If the string of musical instruments is not well tuned, for example, it's too tight or too loose, then it's not possible to play with, play up with a beautiful music. So the effort should not be too strong nor too weak. Sometimes meditators have a strong desire to mindful and note every object or every phenomenon. So when there's a strong desire to make mental notes, so sometimes meditators will be thinking or reflecting that did I miss any mental noting, or did I note the thinking mind, and so on. So when meditators keep on reflecting, did I note that object, did I note the thinking mind, eventually there's a feeling of anxiety. So the mind becomes restless. The mind is not calm. So meditators should learn to practice sometimes with moderate effort, and always mindful and note the present moment. For example, sometimes meditators are mindful of rising movements or the falling movements. And then there's a thought arising that there was the thinking that had passed away a few moments ago. I forgot to note it. So it's not possible to mindful and note a thought or thinking that had passed away. What should be mindful and noted is the presence. I mean this thought that there was a thinking that had passed away few moments ago that I forgot to note it. In fact, such thoughts is also arising and passing away instantly. Sometimes meditators may not able to make any mental noting. They should be aware or be mindful as it is. So sometimes meditators need to mindful and note the present moment. Effort. We always emphasize balance efforts. In one of the previous talk, I did explain with a simile from the commentaries. Then concentration should be kept in balance with effort. If concentration is strong and effort is weak, eventually the mind will become sluggish. Sometimes meditators feel that they could follow the movements of rising falling very well. The movements of rising and falling are very clear. It seems they do not have to put much effort into it. So because the movements are clear, they could perceive it clearly, and they did not sustain the effort. Eventually, effort is getting less and less. Then the mind could become heavy or sluggish. So it's important to sustain the effort. Sometimes meditators are mindful and note one and the same object again and again. The mindfulness could be getting weaker and weaker. So they need to sustain the effort. Sometimes meditators are mindful and note pain many times or for a few minutes, 10 minutes, or longer than 10 minutes. Eventually, the mindfulness is not getting better while noting the pain repeatedly. They could not perceive any changes in that painful sensation. So sometimes meditators may put forth some intentional effort. For example, to direct the mindfulness back to the basic object, such as sitting or touching, or the movement rising, falling, if they are clear enough. As soon as meditators direct the mindfulness back to the basic object, they could feel the pain clearer, stronger, and the mindfulness goes back to the stronger to the pain again. Then they should mindful and note the pain again. It's because when they when they activate the mindfulness, we can say that in this case, meditators activate the mindfulness. If meditators keep on mindful and note pain, 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 the mind or the mindfulness is getting dull or not sensitive to the object. So sometimes they put some intentional effort to direct the mindfulness to the basic object. Then they feel the pain clearer, stronger again. So meditators have to keep these two faculties, effort and concentration, especially during the practice. If meditators are endowed with confidence in the practice, believing that this is the only way taught by the Buddha, leading to the cessation of suffering. And the Buddha also attained enlightenment or cessation of suffering through this way of practice. In those, the Buddha taught us this, the only way of the only way or the practice of four foundation mindfulness through his personal experience. Then we will have confidence in the practice. And we if meditators could put aside the theories of preconceived ideas, then they will be able to keep the faculties in balance with confidence. Then meditators need to keep the faculty of effort and faculty of concentration in balance during the practice. Mindfulness is the most important factor that keeps the mental faculties in balance. So mindfulness is the most important faculties. So we can strengthen it by increasing our effort or mental effort gradually. So it's important to sharpen the five mental faculties. And effort is important. Effort should be ever increasing, should be firm, stable, and one should has a strong aspiration that one should not put down one's responsibility as a human or manusa, as long as one has not yet achieved the goal or the aim, or that's to purify the mind, so that one is endowed with a noble mind. When we meditate or in order to cultivate the mind or to develop the mind, we need a lot of patience and perseverance, as well as effort.